reality, the way it is, not with fears about the worst scenario, and not with hopes like transhumanists just having a very sometimes naive vision of everything is going to be fine. Neither of them. Let's be realistic. Let's think of the human through our history, because of course by the history, in Latin they say historia magistra vitae, in theory history should be teaching us, often that's not the case. But can we learn from history? And what kind of answer are we going to give to these questions? I'm not giving answer by the way in the book, I pose the questions though. For his ecological presence, I think a lot of you read this chapter that was sent thanks to Daniele and Valentina and Megan. So I'm not going to go into details on this because I think some of the questions come specifically from the chapter. So let's go to the next one that maybe some of you did not have the chance to read. Five is cosmic constellation. These I go really out there in the universe, multiverse, and I'm not going to go into the space migration, but I do want to talk about the golden paradox because it's a kind of funny one. I have a strange sense of humor, but I think it's funny. So we have two interstellar probes at the moment going into space. And they have a golden disk in which they were sent in the 70s. The UN chief at the time posed this beautiful message to possible alien life who possibly maybe are going to find them and maybe decipher in the future. And the message is like this. We are humans, we come in peace, we teach if we are given the chance to teach, and we learn if we have the possibility to learn. And I thought it was a beautiful message. But I wonder if it is a very honest message. And I wonder if, let's say that some alien life in some exoplanet, an exoplanet that is rich, let's say, in cobalt, gold, and titanium. And they find this disc, they're very excited, they decipher, they're very intelligent aliens, and they say, oh, let's meet these people, they come in peace. And then they come, and then some humans go, and they realize that this exoplanet is rich in titanium, cobalt, and gold. And since, you know, we're in the land of Americas, where there is a lot of genocide that happened because of human greed, the 3G. They were thinking it was a God, glory, and something else, and greed. God, greed, and glory. So if, you know, knowing from the history of the humans, if we are going to space, are we really going to peace in peace? And I'm not saying this to undermine this beautiful message, but let's say that you love someone very dearly, and this person doesn't know much about modern Homo sapiens. Would you just tell them that we come in peace or not? Take a minute to think about it. So there is someone that you, or to yourself, let's say to yourself of the future, and you are preparing yourself to be part of being human, before you were born, and you need to give yourself a message, would you tell yourself, oh, I'm going to go to a species, they come in peace? I hear some laughing, I would agree on that, but let's see, take a minute. So would you tell yourself, these people come in peace, they can teach me, that's wonderful, they can learn, let's see, that's all you would say to yourself. Would you be safe with that or not? So just curious, how many people would be safe telling themselves to be part of being human, that humans come in peace, they teach if you ask them to teach, and they learn if they're given the possibility to learn? How many people would be safe with these kind of instructions to be coming and meeting humans? No one. One person. Okay, well, that's good. Someone that trusts it. I like that. I like that. All right, so, you know, I personally wouldn't always feel very safe. I would say, yeah, humans can come at peace, can teach if they're given to the chance, can learn, but probably it's not all I would tell myself. I would also say humans, at least modern Homo sapiens, can also be very violent. And so, it's something that when we are in space, we are not migrating to space, we've always been in space. And so when we are thinking about going beyond the human, I think that we need to think about other lives with dignity. And so, you know, there are some interesting reflections here. There's also carbon chauvinism, the idea that we are not finding any life because we go with our own misunderstanding of thinking of life just through carbon-based life, so the type of life that we have on Earth, which is still a limitation. So that's also the favorite chapter of Daniele. That's my limitation five. Okay, this one is one of my favorites, and it's also excellent if you teach. Students usually love this chapter. Because it's really talking about technology, and technology is the topic that move, that shape society at the moment. It's the big topic. It's almost like talking about God in the Middle Ages. Now talk about technology, everyone gets either excited or very angry. Excellent. Good point to talk about, you know? You get rid of a lot of energy. And so in this chapter, there is a lot of reflection, both critical, like, you know, all the, especially being in the States, there are not really many laws that protect you. So there is a lot about talking about technological awareness, big data, the high-tech prophecy, the notion of AI takeover, which is big in this country, the idea that either the technology should be our technological slaves, so they should just work for us, or the fear that they are going to take over. They are going to kill us all. Hollywood is perfect on as an example, you know? The technology that rebels and kills us all, but of course the last human can always do it and boom, with some violence make it all happen. Yeah, I would disagree with that. I think that the high-tech scenario has already happened. I live upstate in New York State, and so I commute twice a week, teaching at NYU, I take the subway, I'm in the train, and I see, I would say, 99 people on the subway just look their phones, and that's me included. AI takeover has already happened. No fear, don't be afraid of that. That has already happened. Accept it. Now, what are we going to do about that? And so how are we dealing with that? And so I think that we need a lot of technological awareness. We need to understand what is technology. Because technology is not coming out of nowhere. There are people coding, there are interests. At the moment, the main driving force of technology is profit. And my question is profit enough of a dynamic force to create something that is shaping human society? Because at this point, you know, it's very interesting. We do, as I said, a lot of exercise in our class at NYU, and I asked the students, one time was a, the class was about technology, how much time is spent on a daily average on the screen? Some of my students spend 18 hours a day on the screen. Now, we're not here to judge, but the point is, even at the level of the embodiment, this is already changing the evolution of our own body. Think of Wall-E. I don't know if any of you is familiar with the Disney movie. When you see humans very fat with the little hands like this. I'm not judging those humans, they're beautiful people. But, yes, you don't need your legs. You're going to be all day long like this. You don't need long legs because you just need a little thing to die. Probably at the point we have microchips in our brain, so forget about that too. But the point is that, like, we need to be thinking about it seriously. And so my question, I was recently in Bangalore, which is the Silicon Valley of Asia, one of the Silicon Valley of Asia, another one being Beijing. This is in India. And so this was a conference about AI, and it was a mix of academic people and people coming from private organizations, actually coding. That's where a lot of coding in Asia is happening, in Bangalore, at least when you talk about India. And so I asked this room full of people, you know, I asked, do you think the profit is enough as a driving force to shape technology? And I'm asking this absolutely with no judgment. I know that profit is important. I know that people want to make some money to pay their bills. I'm not judging. But when something is reshaping human societies, when something is reshaping the human species, can we as a species accept that the main driving force at the moment is profit? Now, I don't know if maybe they were embarrassed or anything like that, but no one raised their hands. And these were people who actually worked in the sector. No one, and these were also very enlightened people, a lot of them are also into spiritual tradition, but anyway, none of them said, yes, profit is enough. Because you can make money doing almost anything. Almost anything. And so, you know, I have the joy and honor to be part of my family here, and Mary, my American sister, she was giving the example that, you know, hearing, but I once she pointed out, I totally shared the experience being in New York and seeing children who are 6 months, who have an iPod in their hands, and they can say iPod before mom. iPod, 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 no mom yet. iPod, iPod, iPod. Now, I want to say this per se is, you know, technological madness, but in Stanford, they've done this this experiment already some years ago. And they have come out with this scientific research where the same part of the brain that gets addicted to cocaine, the drug that I think everyone knows about, is the same part of the brain to which technological addiction is enforced in our brain. So of course in our society, no one would be legally allowed to give cocaine to a child. But we are giving technology at the same, which is actually activating the same part of the brain. Now, these are the questions. Are we okay with that or not? And so I think that this is the time when, and I think it is also very beautiful to see at the many levels, there are a lot of you know, scandals that happen through Facebook, and I'm not happy for the scandals, but I'm happy that it's becoming a public reflection in America as well. Because in Europe, this has been already been discussed for some years, there are different regulations. But in the US, I think it's more of a newer type of discussion. And I'm also very excited to announce that 2 weeks ago, the UN unanimously, so these were 24 countries, from Morocco to South Korea to US, actually the US was the one who proposed the topic, there were 24 countries, Holland, all of them together unanimously saying, we need to think together about AI. It's no longer okay to just let the sector, the private sector, develop these technologies. Because these technologies are changing the human species, and actually the chair used the term existential. These technologies are changing us at the existential level, which I completely agree, actually is the topic of my book. So there are very good news. And again, if you are teaching, technology is a great topic. People really get excited. And this is a chapter that I highly recommend. I want to say one more thing, because I talked a lot about the things that need change. I also want to say that I do believe in the possibility of so-called techno-consciousness. I don't think that technology is something we are using. I'm more of a Heideggerian here, and technology is something that is shaping our experience. It is ontological. It goes well beyond the human. We will never be able to master technology, because technology is an ontological creativity, like anything else. And so I have a section called Enlightened Robots, and I draw here on the work of Masahiro Mori, who was actually, I think he's still alive, he's in the 90s, a Japanese roboticist, very famous for the Uncanny Valley. Some of you may maybe heard this Uncanny Valley theory. But he not only wrote the Uncanny Valley, but he also wrote this other book, it's called The Buddha in the Robot. And according to Buddhism, there is a very interesting notion, the Buddhahood, of the Buddha nature of everything. And so he says, of course the Buddha can be the robot, can be in the robot. I like this notion because it really kind of expand the idea of biocentrism. I'm not a biocentric thinker. And I do believe that awareness is in everything. In order to exist, there must be some type of spark. And so I do believe in technology also as a site of what would you call awareness. I'm not using the notion of consciousness because it's often related to a specific type of biological consciousness. And so we're going to the last 2 meditations. This one is sociocultural agency. This is all about what kind of society do we want. And something that is very dear to me, especially in the situation where there are wars going on at the moment, there are more than 30 wars going on planet Earth at the moment, the notion that war is a kind of recent invention. In fact, it was the first case of, organized war was in the late Neolithic times. So that means that 99% of our history, we did have examples of violence, but not of organized warfare. And that became the kind of the rule in the Iron Ages, which is really not much time ago. I want for all of you to remember that war has not always been with us. It's a new habit that we have, actually it's a new disease that we carry, because kill people, diseases kill people. So war is a new social disease that kills people, and we don't need war. It's going to take some time to learn, to unlearn war, but we can do it, because 99% of our time in history, we were not at war with each other. Actually, we're here because during the Ice Ages, when other species got extinct, like Neanderthal, Denisovan, Homo erectus also got extinct, the humans, one of the main theories, didn't get extinct because of collaboration and taking care beyond the tribe with these gatherings that would happen anyway. So it is a good topic, I think, for the people who are very interested in social change, social justice, social awareness. And then the last chapter is about ontological presence. It is a beautiful chapter that I think goes beyond space and time. I think this chapter could have been written 10,000 years ago and can be written 1 million years from now. It's about who are we at the ontological dimensional level? How do we manifest? And that, of course, goes beyond any era, goes well beyond the Anthropocene. And of course, includes also the notion of non-being, dream, spirituality, self-realization, consciousness hacking. So these are the meditation. The book itself is conceived as a labyrinth. So you can choose any meditation. and you don't have to finish each meditation. They are divided to texts. So it's really conceived in a way to be pleasant. It's still an intellectual book, so it might, you know, tires your brain a little bit, but you don't have to read the whole book. And they all, each chapter says the same thing from different angles. Last thing I want to say, then we go into our all the questions, is that we are back together. I'm actually very happy to be here in presence. Now there are events, you know, as I was mentioning, just coming from India. We're going to have the summer, a lot of you are committed to Roman studies, so I know a lot of you are actually studying in Europe. So we're going to have a Posthuman summer camp in Italy, in Galliera, which is close to Bologna, actually one of the first universities ever created were actually in Bologna. This is the 10th to 13th of August, it's free, you just pay for your own meals. There is absolutely no profit made. And anyone is welcome, and it's all experiential and experimental. So there is no frontal lectures. We are just going to be activities. We're going to be creating the praxis of which Daniele was asking before. So,
I was thinking to make you two more short questions and then open the Q&A moment. So, let's see, in the very last years, of course, many people feel in all its urgency the ecological problem. What does posthumanism have to say about the relationship between humans and the environment, humans and non-humans?
Yeah, it's an important question. So I would say that, and by the way, I also like one of, so for the people who didn't have the chance to see this, we share a document before the event for people to place their questions. As I was reading last night, there is a question about, you know, what about choosing a species in order to save, you know, a habitat? Like, for instance, I remember when I was a kid, it was the panda with the blue wolf and stuff like that, and a species that is going to be... Yeah, so let's go to the ecology. I believe that there is no way we can really change anything if we keep in the narrative of saving the planet. There is no way we can change anything if we keep with the trend that was that started more clearly with the Industrial Revolution. If you think, I'm going to give you an example. If you think of the factory itself, or if you actually, you know, let's go more contemporary, think of big data centers. A big data center is a center that is as remotely disconnected from nature as you possibly be. Because in the end, you know, natural, environmental, biological elements could damage the computers inside. And that's the last thing you want, because data in the 21st century is the goal of the 21st century. Forget about having land, forget about having a real goal, get your data if you want to be rich in the 21st century. If anyone here wants to be rich, go into the data field. Data is the goal of the 21st century. And so of course, when you look at these big data places, they have so much security, more than banks, because the data that you all create for free, none of you is paid, but you create this data, is stored and sold. That's the goal of the 21st century. Now, this is a trend that now is being reversed. And so now we, human, become the saviors to save a dying planet. It is still the same narrative. If we stay with this dualistic narrative, but we just shift the two terms, we are never going to go anywhere. To me, and I don't want to sound pessimistic, because I don't have any goals in life, apart from feeling good about what we're doing. But it's the end of the human, it's the extinction of the species. If we keep in this misunderstanding of the human as separated, so we either take or we save, but we are not dead, it is the deepest existential obfuscation that is going to bring us to extinction. In fact, at the moment, the human is a species. The first reason, the main reason of risk of extinction is human action, anthropogenic action, climate crisis, for instance, or nuclear weapons. Those are the two main causes of possible risk of extinction for the human, because otherwise the human is one of the least risk of extinction. We are actually the reason for many other animals to get extinct, the sixth mass extinction. A lot of this is caused by anthropogenic reasons. So I would say to me, but maybe because I'm a philosopher, but my answer is existential. My answer is about awareness. So to me, the change is at the level of education. That's why I'm part of this discussion right here, right now, at Chapel Hill, with all of you. Because I deeply believe in education as a tool for social transformation. Without that awareness, there is no real change. You can collect all the money to save the pandas, and by saving the pandas, you are filling a forest of bamboo, and that is an invasive plant. So what are you changing? You are helping species and damaging many others. So I would say that it is a shift that is, I think it's also part of evolution on a broader level. And I also want to put a challenging question out there for all of you. And this hit me, I think it was a couple of months ago, and I was thinking, are we in our anthropocentric illusion when we think that we are damaging the planet? So what if the planet is much broader than what we conceive, and maybe we are a dynamic force of the world that maybe is rechanging itself in more of technological ways? I just put a challenging idea here, and I'm not saying that that means that we can just keep destroying the natural environment, but I would like to think on non-anthropocentric premises. And so the first one that comes to my mind is realizing that you are not saving anyone. If the planet is dying, we are dying. Because at the moment, the only planet in which we can live without any sort of exosphere is planet Earth. And the other side of it is, I was going on my way here, and I'm actually teaching this course at NYU, and we're actually talking about the Anthropocene. And so we're talking about, for instance, the idea of Heidegger, of nature as a standing reserve with the Industrial Revolution. So now we are separating, we can take from nature as much as we can. And now I was at Newark to come here, and I was just observing humans. And everyone was so stressed out. Everyone was on the phone reading because maybe they lost their flight or something. Everyone is so much stress. And I realized that's why we are thinking of nature as a standing reserve, because we think of ourselves as a standing reserve. This obfuscation is not just that we are treating better nature, we are treating better than ourselves. We go as much as we can until we die. I have an example, I live in Newport, and it's a beautiful university, SUNY. And there was a professor of chemistry who recently died at campus while teaching. He was 83 years old. And he really liked teaching, but I wondered if he really liked teaching or he was afraid of stop teaching to maybe have nothingness, emptiness to prepare himself. I don't know the answer, I didn't know him personally. But my question is, are we treating nature this way because we are treating ourselves this way? Most people are stressed, are depressed, are not in shape. So I wonder if, the idea is like, well, if by understanding who we are, by treating, by caring about ourselves, then we can take care of nature. Because nature is not separated. And also it is a new idea of nature being separated from the human. So I don't know if I answer this question, but of course we can always go back to this.
Thank you. So my very last question is this. Let's see. Reconsidering our conceptualization of the human from a posthumanist perspective includes reformulating our understanding of the relationship between life and death. Could you please tell us more about this matter?
What a great question. Very deep, and I think it's perfect because I know a lot of you are into spiritual tradition, religion, so maybe we can connect for the open discussion. I'm going to say something that maybe is a little extreme, but I would say that the idea of life in separation from death, it is a kind of a new notion. Because if we look at all the Paleolithic time, if we look at the notion of the great goddess, which was revered at that time, which was not by any way the gendered mother that you can think of nowadays, it is not your genetic mother, it is the mother of the universe. Or if you want, in maybe the Greek or Christian tradition, is the mother of God, is the mother who is not necessarily female, is everything. In fact, all these figurines that are found through the Paleolithic and Neolithic time are not just female. They have the beak of a bird, they have the tail of a snake, they have feathers. They are not just human, they are not just female. And it is the idea of the great cycle of time. And so the regeneration is beyond life and death, is a complete cycle. By the way, all traditional societies, all of them, none of them is excluded, none of them thought of time as linear. All of them were cyclical, because of course the season of, if you think of like autumn, fall, spring, summer, of life and death, of seeing a body dead, then from the dead body you have worms, and then you have flowers, and then you have a plant. There is no ending, there is just a great transformation. And that it comes from all tradition, still in contemporary, for instance, Taoism, that is very clear, and many other traditions. So I would say that this very dualistic understanding that is part of some contemporary societies, or you either alive or you're dead, is not something that is shared within our DNA. We don't have that in our DNA, in our cultural DNA. On this, I would like to say that, for instance, transhumanism has a very interesting notion of death. In fact, in transhumanism, a dead person is not called dead, it's called a patient. Because as I was mentioning before, some reason that is killing you now might be a very easy fix, it might be 200 years from now. And so in transhumanism, the notion of death is not there as a final point, but as a process. And so, for instance, people who are interested in cryonized, they want to be cryonized pretty quickly within the process of death. So I would say that it is on one side something that we can reshape as a cycle. On the other side, I also love, I have to quote again Heidegger, although he was not a nice person, he was an arrogant Nazi, he was sexist, he was not a nice friend, but he was a very good philosopher. So I'm going to bring Heidegger again, sorry if you are not happy with that. Some people don't love Heidegger because of his biographical thing. I don't want to forget his dark biography, but he said a lot of interesting things. And so with Heidegger, he sees death as the reminder of what do you want to achieve in your life. Because that is the great reminder that if you don't do it now, there is no tomorrow. That's it. Or if you want to go, for instance, to the opposite of that, Nietzsche, who was a great master for Heidegger, studying Nietzsche deeply. For Nietzsche, it's the opposite. Think of your life as something that could always come back. So that you're going to live the life that is the best work of art you can ever imagine. And so here comes the thought experiment of the eternal recurrence of the same, which we can do before we go into the Q&A. This is one of the most powerful exercises that I've done in my life. And for me, it's a great pleasure to share with you. It comes from Friedrich Nietzsche, Das Volk Zarathustra. So I'm going to ask all of you to take a minute. And I want you to think of all your life, everything about it. All the people that you've met, the food that you've eaten, the places where you've been, your dreams, vision, intentions, everything about it, nothing excluding, everything. So take a minute to think all your life exactly what it is. You cannot change anything about it. Think about your life. And then he asks a very deep question. He says, would you say yes to that life, exactly the way it is? You cannot change anything. There is no cheating here. You cannot change anything about it. So he's going to say, if I tell you, actually he said if a demon, but demon comes from the Greek tradition, because it doesn't say in the Christian sense of something bad. So let's just say he says that if your life was going to come back exactly the same, forever and ever, nothing that you can change, exactly the same, would you say yes to that life? So he says, if you say yes, you are the Übermensch, the overhuman, the child, the one who can play with life, because you no longer are attached to any category. And this is the metamorphosis of the spirit, from the camel, the student who carried the books, to the rebel, the lion, the punk, the rebellion, enough is enough, to the child, the one who can play with existence, because everything can be anything else. So if you can say yes to your life, exactly the way it was, he said, you are the Übermensch. Now, if you say no to this question, there is nothing to be feeling sad about. It just means that maybe from now on, you can answer that question to yourself. And I've done this, I studied Nietzsche when I was 16 years old, and he had such an impact on my life. So every time I find myself with big questions of choices, you know, would I do this or that? I do this exercise. I think, would I say yes to this forever? And if the answer is no, then I'm not going to do it. I'm not saying that you should not take the exam to pass the exam, because you're doing the exam in order to go to the intention, to the vision that you have. So of course, doesn't mean to take the short road. I don't want to do anything, I don't want to brush my teeth, then you can count it. I'm not saying that. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the big macro structure of your life. And so, what is that is a yes? And why is a yes? And what is it is a no? And why is it no? And do you need that no? Because you can say, I need to pass that exam because I want, for instance, to have my degree, then go for it. But if you are offered a job and you wouldn't like to see yourself there forever, or not even for 1 month, why would you accept it? Because your life is not going to come back. So I would just say that, you know, time can be seen as a cycle, so I think that helps a lot. I love the idea of the spiral more than just a cycle keeping repeating. Nietzsche talked about the same, I think, as a thought experiment. But going to end death and death, I think that death can be super powerful. During the pandemic, to end the way we started, death shook me again. Allow me to realize that there was it. I didn't know if I had it tomorrow. I hope I did, because as a child, I want to give her a very long mama, eh? Because it's, I think it's important to have a mama for a long time. But I also thought, you know, like, death reminds you that you need to do what you need to do, because there is no tomorrow. There is only the present. So I would like to thank so much everyone for this wonderful, wonderful presentation. And I would like to maybe open the question and the comments and the insights and all the things that to be said. And first of all, to applaud everyone who have been here and everyone who is contributing to our collective consciousness, which is all of us.
Thank you, Dr. Ferrando. And if you have questions for them, this is the right moment.
Oh, I asked the question about the flagship species in post-human ecology. So thank you so much for responding. It was really enlightening, and I appreciate it a lot. I'm finding another question, because I had another one in the document. I saw a video of Carrie Wolf from like 2012. It could be very possible that he has very different opinions now. But for those of you who aren't familiar with Carrie Wolf, he's considered one of the founders of post-human theory. And so I was watching a video, and it was very interesting, because he says something along the lines of that like, post-humanism is not a rejection of humanism necessarily, or a transcendence of humanism, and that those ideas could coexist together. And so I was wondering kind of what you thought of that in terms of developing a post-human praxis.
What a great question. Yeah, so I would say that, of course, how do you define humanism? Because there are so many different types of humanism. You have Renaissance humanism, you have Confucianist humanism, there are so many traditions. So I, and of course, you know, also are we talking about humanism or anthropocentrism? Because I was in this conference, and I remember this philosopher saying, well, you know, anthropocentrism can also help the current human species to do something about, for instance, the current sixth mass extinction. Because if you want to save yourself, you want, you know, to understand the ecological crisis. I think there are ways to go about it. And I give you another example. I used to live in New York City. I was raised in big cities. I was born in Torino, which is a big Italian city. And then I lived in nature, but I mostly lived in big cities. After the pandemic, I actually moved up upstate New York. And this time I was taking a bike ride, in a very, let's say, wild area where there are coyotes. And this was in the evening. And I was there in silence and just listening to the sounds of so-called nature. And all of a sudden I hear movements around. And I literally felt, I really hope this is a human. Not that I would be, you know, probably coyotes would not attack me. But to me it was much more pleasant, the idea of maybe some humans, than having a group of coyotes coming close to me, too close to me, you know? Now, if this was Central Park, it would be very different. I would probably, if I was in the night on my own in Central Park, instead of hoping for some humans, I hope there would be some rats. Because that's what you find in New York City, a lot of rats. I learned a lot about them living there. So I would say that